happening.
So,
yeah. Okay. All right, we'll get started. Good evening. It's 7:05. We're starting a little bit late tonight, but welcome to the Thursday, December 15th, 2016 meeting of the school committee. If you could all join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, I'm going to run through our agenda and then we'll get started. Tonight we have recognitions with the Varsity Girls Volleyball State Champions with us. We have our first opportunity for public comment, and we have reports to the school committee by student council, liaisons, the school committee chair report, as well as the budget report from Dr. McLeod. Under new business, we have a preschool paraprofessional need to discuss, and under old business, we have the HCA parking agreement. We'll have our second opportunity for public comment and then our items by consensus and then seek to adjourn around 9:05. We'll see, Ralph, if I can catch up on our time. And so with that, Dr. McLeod, recognitions.
Oh, I was all ready for student council. So, because I'm so excited they're here tonight, but I'm also really excited tonight to welcome the Varsity Girls Volleyball State Champions. I was actually at the game, at the championship game with my husband, and it was so much fun. It was fun watching you just because of the sportsmanship, your talent, of course, but it felt like, and I said this to Ms. King after the game, it felt like you just never got discouraged and you were having fun the whole time. And so it's so much fun to have you here tonight. I am going to ask Ms. King to introduce your coaches and then your coaches to introduce all of you. So can you all just please come on up?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can come right in front of us.
Right there,
yeah.
And face the camera. In front. So you can face the camera.
Face the camera.
Oh, wow. And it's so impressive that you all made it out, too.
Yeah. All right. Well, thanks for having us here tonight. We have two of our coaches here tonight. Margie Grabmeier is the varsity head coach, and we have Mary Granfield, who is Margie's assistant. And I think we're going to have the girls introduce themselves. So,
yeah, I would like to say thank you also for having us. And thank you so much for coming to the match. Our fans were amazing this year, and I think that during the tournament run, that kind of helped us the rest of the way. I mean, we definitely were inspired by the support that we got. And at this time, I would like the girls to introduce themselves.
Awesome. Okay, hi, I'm Mikhail Fucci.
I'm Ivy Gogolin.
Allison Moret.
Jess Miller.
Amanda Gilbert.
Julia Canastari.
Brooke Parker.
Jenna Wilbur.
Jill Sarcusco.
And I was going to say Mary Bransfield, grade 12. But
and how many of you girls are seniors? Show of hands, higher.
Uh-oh.
Three. So we've got still lots of hope in the future for how many juniors? Yeah, wow. So, well, keep having fun. How many of you play another sport now, a winter sport? Hands in hand. And so you do all of this, and you get your studies done, and you show up at school committee meetings looking bright-eyed and beautiful, and thank you so much. It's just delightful to have you here to start off our budget meeting.
Congratulations. I feel very short next to the volleyball team.
It's feeling the same way.
I don't remember how tall our girls volleyball team was, but so at this time we have our first opportunity for public comment. I don't know if anyone's here to speak on behalf of the public. Doesn't look like it. So we can move on to our reports area. And we have our student council members with us. So please come and join us up at the table next to Mrs. Richmond.
Yes, we have Parker Petruni and Ryan Branch with us here tonight. And what year are you?
We're both seniors.
We're both seniors. Yep.
Well, thanks for being here.
Thank you for having us. I just came from a track meet. I know we're both very busy, so we're both kind of underdressed.
Yeah. But
you'll be warm.
Yeah.
Thank you. Just over the past 2 weeks, we've had a number of, I guess, wintry sort of events at HHS. I know on Tuesday this week, we had our band holiday concert, and On Wednesday, we had our orchestra and choral concert, I believe. And I participate in band and jazz band, and it was great to see not only our parents there, but there were some members from the community, and I know I had some friends come, and that was very fun.
And we also had the Alice Drill last week, which was the new safety approach to the intruder coming in. So basically Mr. Bishop went over the announcements and said where the intruder was in the school, and we all had to react as if he was actually there and what we would do. So some people evacuated some if they were in the right place, and some of us just barricaded the door and stayed in the corner. So that's what we did, and that helped people, the freshmen especially, who haven't done that. And then we also had the security dogs, is that what it is?
Canine unit,
yeah,
today.
The canine unit was today. So that was another safety thing that we did.
Kind of going along, I guess following up the volleyball, the winter sports started right after Thanksgiving. And I know something that's new this year is we have a competitive ski team. We've always had a ski club for as long as I can remember, but we actually have a ski racing team this year, and that's pretty cool. I don't do that, but I know I have a couple friends on the team, and they're very excited, and they're ordering their winter jackets and stuff like that. So that seems pretty cool, pretty new.
And then we also have the Keep Smiling Toy Drive that we're continuing this year, and we're trying to gain a lot more support for that, because we just want it to be more of a success this year rather than in past years, with our school community. So we've been really trying to promote that through student council. And then our Keep Smiling Day, where we all wear the t-shirts, is next Monday.
And tomorrow we actually have an ugly sweater day at the high school. Both teachers and students participate in that. It's kind of a fun day to kind of celebrate the winter spirit and the holiday spirit in school and be nice and warm while doing it. Another thing new at HHS is we started a newspaper this year called the HHS Press. I know it started in the journalism class, but one of the people in the class, Michael Carlis, made it into a club outside of school. So I know today was the first meeting, and I went to the first meeting. Actually, it was pretty interesting to see. We basically planned out a whole paper with different stories for around the town and the school, and it's interesting to go through the journalism process or the research and stuff. So that's very new.
And then student council, we're going to Christmas in the City in Boston this Saturday from 3 to 5, and we're taking the train in, and we're going to volunteer. So I don't really know exactly what we're doing this year, but 2 years ago we just painted the murals and bagged the cotton candy for the kids. It's really fun, really good way to bond student council together too, and just volunteer in the community.
And just the last couple things we have. on Friday last week, we had a Be Free, which is a club at the high school, Be Free Coffee House, which is an event. They have a couple of them a year where it's just a couple of acoustic performances for people to sing and people to go and watch. And I know this year we've started hosting them at the HCA right across the street, which is really, really great. Because in past years, we've had to do them over in Ashland or other places. I think we've done them in Holliston before, but having them at the HCA and kind of right on the school campus is really great, because I think it brings more people to the events, too, having it such close. And the last thing is, we hosted, as a high school, our first robotics competition. We did that in the AC, and I know, talking to Mr. Bishop and from people on the robotics team, it went really well. I think we had about 24 teams there, they said, which is pretty interesting. I've never been to a robotics competition, but we're also hosting another one on January 14th, so the first and more to come. So I think that's all we have new from HHS over the past 2 weeks, but
I just wanted to point out, as I'm listening to all of the many and varied things that are going on, that we had a conversation with the school committee, and we will be again tonight, about the HCA parking agreement. And one of the questions was just one of the hopes in when they were building that there was that there could be collaboration between the schools and the HCA. And this is an example, the Be Free concert, where you use that space and you just called out how much you enjoy using it and being right here on the campus at no cost to the schools. Mm-hmm. And so I think that these are the kinds of things that are going on, and it's really exciting, I feel, opportunities for both organizations. So that was an important one to call out.
I know last year in my English class, we actually used the HCA for a whole week of classes. We did this interesting activity that had to combine a little bit of acting and a little bit of, like, screenwriting and stuff. So we actually went over there to use their sort of open space as, like, a stage, kind of. And we used that for every class during that week period. So, yeah, just another example of that.
Yeah. And then I just was also going to say thank you. I mean, I know how busy you all are with sports and with academics and everything else, and the fact that you take so much time to give back, both to your own community and then, you know, to traveling into Boston, giving up a Saturday, it just makes us all so proud of you as students. We're all here doing what we do because we want to support you, and it just makes me really proud to listen to you and to hear about all the wonderful things that you're doing to give back. So thank you.
Thank you.
I also wanted to say that your new newspaper for the school, if they ever want to come, you know, take pictures of recognitions where we have students and things from the high school, they're more than welcome. And certainly welcome them coming. And if they had any questions for us, we'd be happy to take part in that.
So. I think they would actually love to do that. So I'll suggest that.
Right.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Have a good night. Happy holidays.
You too.
All right, so moving on to our liaison reports. Did anyone have meetings in the last week, 2 weeks, I guess, since our last liaison reports?
Yes, we've had a couple of charter committee meetings. We had a public forum, and then we met again last night to review the feedback from the public forum and work on some revised recommendations based on that feedback. And I believe that in addition to that, that a member of the charter committee, probably the chair, Pam Waxlax, will be going to different committees to present or to discuss with them what the recommendation is going to be about the pieces that touch their particular committee. And so it may be that she'll ask to come to our meeting and talk about, it's mostly what we've already talked about, the changes to the budget process that are proposed in the charter, but just a heads up that that may be coming. And then, of course, everyone should go to town meeting, special town meeting on January 30th to deliberate and debate and vote.
All right. Anything, Nancy? No?
SBC met, but I was out of town, so we'll have to wait for John for that one.
Okay.
Unless you have a recap.
I don't have a recap on ESBC, to be honest with you. So, because actually, now that I think about it, it was last week, and that's far out of my brain at this point. I did have a CPAC meeting where Dr. McLeod and Dr. Zaleski and Dr. Kavanaugh, we had a full house of administrators at this meeting, and we had the Accept Collaborative Executive Director, was she? I'm sorry, I'm not knowing.
Yes, the Executive Director.
Mm-hmm. The Executive Director and the Finance Director had both attended and had a presentation for the CPAC team on the transportation concerns, and not just on the transportation concerns, but also describing what Accept and the Collaborative do and how they work with the district, what they've put in place for remediation for some of the issues that we are experiencing with Accept over the past years, what changes they put in place, for instance, cameras in the vans, the new GPS systems, new ways of reaching the drivers so that they are still not using their phones but have not handheld devices, but ways that they can reach them so that there isn't that communication gap. And then in addition, they increased their hours for their dispatchers and also added a dispatcher to allow for more communication with parents if there are concerns or there's timing issues or something's going on. I thought the conversation was actually very good, and they gave us a lot of information. And then Dr. Kavanaugh presented another great presentation on all of the gains that the district has made, although she was laughing because she said that was the third time I've seen it and that I could start explaining some of the slides, but it was exciting to see it all over again anyway, and especially because we had such a special education focus in this discussion. So, and I think a lot of the parents had not seen the gains that had been made on our MCAS score, so that was a really positive interaction as well. And that was really it. That meeting was jam-packed. And I don't have any other reports because we did not have a meeting with the town manager for budget, so I didn't have any other things that came up. So we can move right on to Dr. McLeod and the budget report.
Mr. Manning, would you like to join us?
Oh, I guess I skipped my chair report, huh?
Oh. Would you want to do that while he approaches?
Sure. There's not much to give you on the chair report other than I know that we had received one communication from the public about some questions on curriculum for special education, which I didn't forward you my response after we have so aptly learned about all the open meeting law requirements on my forwarding my responses. So what I wanted to explain to you today was that all I did was acknowledge that we got the email and that the expertise was not with any of us. It would be with Dr. McLeod and Dr. Zaleski, and I copied Dr. McLeod and Dr. Zaleski on the email to respond to some of those more broad curriculum questions. And then actually Dr. McLeod and I had a great meeting today to talk about a potential public forum that we could have to go a little bit deeper and allow the public some more access into what our various curriculums and interventions are as far as reading issues and what literacy coaches and things we have in the district. So that will be forthcoming in another meeting. We just are at the infancy of that discussion. But so that was how that was addressed. Otherwise, we haven't actually had a lot of community outreach at all. So I didn't have anything else to report on.
Do you want to mention our guest, though?
Oh, I did earlier, just prior to us.
But I will.
We have, I'm sorry now, I'm going to forget your name, our last name, Paul, but we have a school committee chair member from Leicester who's come to watch our meeting tonight, which may be a little bit boring because we have a light schedule tonight. But they are embarking on their own MSBA project for a new building, and we're excited by our process and our website. But also just trying to get more information on how other school committees run in other districts. So we're pleased to have you, and I actually feel no. and so welcome and thank you very much. And Mr. Manning, we are so happy to have you.
Mr. Kamala was not able to make it tonight, and I have not heard from Mr. Hur.
Okay. They obviously have been here for all the rest of the budget presentations, but thank you for joining us for the finale, so to speak. So we'll let you kick it off.
Okay. Well, I am delighted to be here with my team tonight. And as I was getting ready to begin tonight, I thought, oh, isn't this interesting? It is Mr. Dumas's last final budget proposal meeting, which he is reminding me of every day. And then it's Dr. Kavanaugh's first. And so I just thought that was kind of interesting. But just before this meeting, we did have a meeting with NASDAQ, as you know, Ralph. And it just is not going to be the same next year without having you sit there through all of this process and really guide all of us. Some of the many things that we were saying over there was just qualities that people look to in you. And one of them that comes to mind with the budget process is how you help get us to this point in a way that we can present to the school community an understandable budget that really articulates the things that are important. So thank you both for being here.
I was a very bashful child.
But I also want to say, you know, your help through this whole process and ending where we did last week really made us feel that we have a very different approach to the school committee, to this budget presentation this time, and you'll soon pick up why. And that's why this presentation is very much the work of the three of us. I also wanted to echo my thanks to all of you and to John in your absence for the amount of attention that you provide to what we give you, to the thoughtful questions, to, you know, the preparation that you do coming to each of these meetings makes it really helpful in us doing our work. To the central office team, that this really takes on the bulk or real focus of our work from October right through to this moment, and it takes all of us working to be able to produce what we do. The entire admin team, you've seen them here, you just know how top-notch they are, but there, through this entire process, was never any hesitancy about, you know, I need this, and, you know, I need it more than you do. There was none of that, ever. Just the collaboration has been outstanding. To the community for supporting our budget, but our students to achieve in the way that we do, that we called out at a recent meeting when Carol was presenting, that takes, it does take a village. And then again, Mike, I know that Lori's already thanked you, but that's taken another whole level. Mr. Herr was here for every meeting. Mr. Kamala was here when he could be. So when we're referring to the liaisons, that's all of you. And so with that, we really thought that tonight's presentation had to be thinking more about an education that focuses on the whole child. This budget supports all of these areas. This is not just about academics, and we feel very strongly, all of the admin, our whole team, that without all of the things that the budget supports, we would not be able to be performing in the way that we are. We talk about social emotional wellness, we talk about, you know, the awards that we were just with the volleyball team here tonight. These things provide students with a well-rounded education, opportunities to do things other than academics, which in the end, then we know, helps them perform better. So when we even think about having to cut back any of these things that are provided in our town for these kids, we know that it would be very, very challenging to even begin to think about where that might be. You can see that academics, obviously, is what we're about, but we are thrilled to work in a community that can support students in this well-rounded way. So with that, Carol's going to talk about some of these areas.
So I did want to take just a couple of moments to think about the ways in which we are able to educate the whole child. It's very interesting to see that some of our kids will come to school every day and attend 6 academic classes, but sometimes it's that extracurricular, or it's that athletic piece, or something that happened in the art classroom that can really shape who that child is and also very much motivate them. I mean, at the beginning of our meeting tonight, you could see that we had our volleyball team here who are state champions. There are many kids who go to school in many districts where that would never become a reality for a variety of reasons. And so on these next couple of slides, what I've tried to do is give you some qualitative and quantitative data to sort of support that idea that we really are educating the whole child. If you take a look at the third paragraph up there, you can see that we've had kids in Hopkinton who have signed letters of intent to dive at UConn, to play lacrosse at U Tampa. We have someone going to Dartmouth to run cross country and track. And those things are amazing achievements for those particular students. But we also had a couple of student council kids here tonight who said, I apologize for being underdressed, but I just came from practice. And so they really do identify with those kinds of things, and they really instill confidence in children. It gives them something else beyond the regular school day. And I think that for some kids, it really can be life-altering. If you just go to the next slide. So I want to point out this fine arts slide. I had asked each one of the directors to give me a little bit of information about the ways they believe their programs sort of shape kids beyond the regular school day. And so Colleen Giannino, who is the fine arts director, had shared this with me. Not only, she had a wealth of quantitative data, Not only in last year's 15-16 school year did we have 5 students win gold keys, 8 win silver keys, and 20 honorable mentions. That's genuinely like nearly unheard of in a public high school in Massachusetts. But I wanted to share some of that anecdotal information with you as well. So Colleen sort of encourages the kids to take their work and to submit it. And that very first speaker up there does tell us at the end of what she had to say. And she's talking about being a graphic design major. But she says to Colleen, "I'd like to thank you for having the appreciation for your own students' work to the extent of entering us into the Scholastic Arts and Writing Awards. Without that silver key, I may have never had the motivation to head toward this field." For that particular child, winning that instilled that kind of success and confidence that she could do something with that after graduation, and ultimately she has. But the third speaker down as well is very interesting to me, because there's a student who, even though she has gone off to college to be a business major, she has sort of parlayed her high school art education into something else at the college level. And she says that she is currently working on a senior capstone, which she demonstrates why design deserves a higher seat at the corporate table. And I think what a fascinating combination, and this is something that student was able to generate on her own.
Right?
Yep. And the last one that I will talk about is the engineering program, because it's relatively new, and it's something that I think Doug Scott is really trying to build here. Our student council folks were good enough to talk a little bit about how we had our first robotics competition at Hopkinton High School. But as you take a look at that, you can also see that kids are garnering all kinds of accolades around this. And as we take a look at that, we can see that 6 students from the Technology Engineering Honors Team Robotics course have qualified for state championships, and that this is a program that has also filtered its way into the middle school as well as Hopkins. So it's really having a profound effect on a number of buildings. So I guess I would just say that the kind of programming that we are offering are probably second to none, and I think that kids in Hopkinton benefit greatly from that. I think we also have exceptional professional development, and I know that I've talked about this in my achievement slides, but I think it bears repeating that we have ongoing professional development in the K-5 buildings in foundations. Foundations helps our students to gain those kinds of foundational skills in phonemic awareness, phonics, word study, high-frequency word study, fluency, vocabulary, handwriting, and spelling. Foundations doesn't quite cover, we also have Fountas and Pinnell to do, and so Fountas Pinnell will do guided reading. It does benchmark assessments. It ensures that kids have instructional level reading as well as independent reading, and we have running records that teachers can conduct for kids whenever they actually see fit. So not every student would have repeated running records, but if there's a particular child and we're looking to see if his fluency or comprehension is growing, for example, we could do that every other week, and teachers are now getting really high quality professional development in that. And then we also have Leslie Laud from SRSD, who comes in regularly to ensure that we now have a vertically articulated writing program that spans from K to 8. At the middle school and high school levels, the subject matter leaders and the curriculum teacher leaders are guiding all of our teachers to build common assessments. So it doesn't matter which teacher a student has, they should be encountering a common assessment at the end of a unit of study. And after that, we don't just say, okay, so we've had this common assessment, but rather what happens is the teachers sit down, they look at student work, and they decide if there were places that students fared well, if they didn't fare well, and why. I have my own interesting anecdote. I was in a PLC this morning with a subject matter leader here at the high school, and they were preparing for midterm exams and looking back at last year's midterm. And a question came up about the text that they were offering on the midterm. Was it too difficult, or was it not too difficult for honors level students? And one of the teachers argued that it really was the kind of a text that would help us to see who was reading it at very high levels of proficiency, so they wanted to keep it. But they encountered a question where last year only 45% of the kids got the question right. And so at that point, they thought, okay, so if we're going to keep this here, maybe what we need to do is provide more scaffolding. Maybe what we need to do is alter that question because the question was bad. Maybe what we need to do is take look at why only 45% of them got it right, and then teach something afterward that will help kids to become better at close reading. So a lot of things come out of that instructionally. And I think that that's part of the reason why we've started to see these gains, because of the presence of the CTLs and the SMLs. SRST is also continuing into grade 6 to 8, as I had said, but at the middle school, it's not just ELA. The Social Studies Department has picked it up as well. In the spring, we'll be bringing in Landmark. We currently have a sixth grade classroom that is a language-based classroom. We're going to try to get training at the other grade levels so that students who have language processing disorders or have different language needs will be able to be taught in a language-based classroom. And this year, we also had Dr. Mahesh Sharma come in, who did a day of professional development with the grade 6 to 8 teachers, so that the instruction that we have moves away from algorithms and focuses a whole lot more on math concepts. And then I'll give you just a snapshot of some of the great things happening in each building in terms of achievement. Typically when I do this, I don't offer you much information about Center School because we've often looked at MCAS data. But you should know that Center School does, in fact, have all kinds of data that they are working with. So they do have their benchmark assessment system testing that happened in the fall. And we're going to know a lot more about the kinds of gains that we're seeing in K and 1 classrooms when they do their winter benchmarks. But using running record right now, just as something that we can use anecdotally across classrooms, we're actually seeing growth anywhere between 1 to 5 grade levels in some of those classrooms. So not grade levels,
reading levels.
Reading levels, yeah, I'm sorry. In some of those classrooms. That's pretty astounding data. We have the SRSD, and again, right now it's very qualitative at Center School because a lot of those students are really doing performance-based writing. But if you go into Center School, you can start to see that performance-based writing all over the walls in classrooms. And what ultimately happens is a student has a portfolio, so you can see their beginning writing and their end writing. They do use the scales to quantitatively measure it as well, but we feel like at that grade level, the qualitative information we get is probably better than the quantitative information. And we took a look at AIMSWeb Math. It does proficiency in 4 areas: oral counting, number identification, missing numbers, and quantity determination. And at this point, we would say approximately 88% of the kids at Senta have met their fall benchmarks. I know you've seen the data coming out of Elmwood. These are their best scores, really, in the past 4 years. 64% of those kids scored advanced in math. That is really unheard of in grade 3. Those were astounding scores for third graders in math. And 89% of them were either proficient or advanced in math. 86% of the students scored proficient or above in ELA, and we looked at the Title I students' ORQ writing scores, and we did notice that those scores went up pretty markedly, and we attribute that to the work that they're doing with SRSD in the writing. And when we looked at all the students' scores, we could see that in the all-student category, what happened at Elmwood was that they actually exceeded the target number for what DESE would have expected at Elmwood. At Hopkins, we have talked an awful lot about the kinds of work that's going on over there with our special education population. And I think that these 3 boxes up here show us very nicely the kinds of growth that has happened for that demographic. If you look at 2014, students with high needs, 40% of them got to the benchmark. Students with disabilities, 34%. In 2015, high needs went to 50, and students with disabilities went to 54. And in 2016, the high needs students reached 61%, and students with disabilities reached 62%. I know you've seen this slide many times. I tell you all the time it's my favorite. But this is where the middle school reached level 1 for the very first time in the history of Hopkinton Middle School. And at the high school, I actually have 2 slides there. Hopkinton High School continues to be a level 1 school. And I think that what we're starting to see is they're a level 1 school because their special education population makes great gains. But we're also seeing that more and more students who are on IEPs are finding their way to 4-year colleges. So if you look at 2014, 68% of the students who have an IEP went on to a 4-year college. In 2015, it went up to 76%. And in 2016, it went up to 82% of the students who are on IEPs went off to four-year colleges. I think that that is pretty remarkable.
Thank you, Carol. And I should mention that all of this after tonight will be posted to our website. We know that some of this is repetitive for you, but it's in there because we want to be able to post it for anybody who would like to see the entire story. So I thought it was also important to call out programmatic changes supported in past budgets, because we've talked extensively about tying achievement to program and evidence that the programs that you've supported, that the town has supported in past budgets, have really proven to be successful. So I call some of them out on this slide, and I did go back to the two previous budgets as well, just to look at the specific things that were supported and that were prioritized. We called them priority initiatives in past budgets. The subject matter leader, the things that Carol was just talking about, that Evan mentioned, were kind of byproducts. It wasn't really what we were looking or thought what we thought we were going to. Unexpected positive consequence. We really were thinking more about the supporting the education evaluation process and how that was going to be helpful. But the impact that it's had on teaching and learning and coaching has been dramatic. Some of the evidence that you're starting to see on the special education results that you're seeing in every building has to be attributed to some of these models. The co-teaching model that is really shown evidence of being very powerful. Full day kindergarten and the impact that that's having on fewer identified needs around particularly reading. But I liked that slide. I hadn't seen that one, Carol, until today on the math. 88% of kids on benchmark in December. For we look at K-1 as being, well, we've still got several months to get them there. Obviously benchmark changes as the months go by, but to have them already on benchmark in December is really encouraging to know. They're in school all day now. It just makes sense. The adjustment counselor and what we talked to you last two meetings ago about zero restraints. This is an example about kids getting the help that they need when they need it. De-escalating, bringing in additional counseling to provide the social-emotional support that students need. You've supported additional BCBAs that as well have taken on that more of that teaching role, the role of working with paraprofessionals and teachers who don't have the behavioral background. Brian, you're looking quizzical, and I'm searching for what the acronym stands for.
Board certified.
Look at you, Mr. Dumas. Board certified behavior analyst. Obviously, so much support for the technology budget, and then some of the improvements in engineering over the past couple of years have been very much appreciated.
I swear there's a window open over here.
I'm going to point the heater at you in a minute. Maybe.
Oh, yes, please.
The heater is there. So I'm not going to read this slide, but what I did specifically for tonight's meeting was I called out those strategic initiatives that are particularly supported by this budget. So within all of the strategic initiatives that we have in our document, I called out those that really speak to what we're looking at this year. So you can see under one, we have two particular pieces, aligned curriculum, this piece of the new science standards, this is what's keeping us on target for where we need to be, effective instruction, using student assessment results particularly, so 3-1-A. 3-2-A is a preschool program evaluation. I call this out to you to say, because I know that you always want us to really be using the strategic plan as an active living plan. And in the strategic plan for this year was that we were going to do the preschool program evaluation. It was on board. We weren't going to do it year one. We weren't going to do it year two. So these things are very specifically, we're on target following our strategic plan. We have not amended the strategic plan in any way. We've reprioritized, and we have certainly been looking annually at what things have been achieved, but it really very much has been driving our work in a very focused way. And then
the 4-2-A has been really front and center in goal setting within our departments, with our principals, this idea of actually using the data to plan and adjust instruction and evaluate student learning is something that you will hear us talk a lot about, is very much a part of what Dr. Kavanaugh is looking for when she's evaluating building administrators, and what building administrators in turn are looking for when they're evaluating teachers. So the way in which the strategic plan is connected to not only the budget, but our teacher evaluation process needs to be. I think it's important to point it out because I think it makes it very strong, very powerful. One of you, I think it might have been Mike, one of you, anyway, I think it was you, Mike, last time, talked about unfunded mandates and said there's always going to be unfunded mandates. And I thought, that is a good slide. We need to talk about that, because in addition to all of the things that we do that are supported by the budget, and in addition to all of the things that we do to keep focused on our strategic plan, we are also managing unfunded mandates that come to us and every other district across the Commonwealth that don't provide, not only take time away from the many things that we've called out that we're doing, but come to us without any additional funding. So when we build the budget, we are not building any additional monies for these unexpected unfunded mandates. Sometimes we're given warning, but this first one, the ELL requirement, it's really important to understand that it's not only additional teachers, but the amount of time and money that has gone into teacher training and supporting teacher training and having our own trainers. There was one, I know last year we came and we asked for $9,000 so that we could support an in-district trainer so that teachers could attend the training in-district at no cost, because we felt it was important to prepare our teachers. So those are the kinds of things. We knew that new science standards were coming. We were warned for several years, but there was no money attached to it. So there's a few others out here. Did you want to add? You looked like you did.
No,
okay. The restraint regulations that came with 6 months warning as of January of this year, 2016, these updated restraint regulations had to be in place. It's great. They're great improvements. But there was a requirement that had to be, you know, in terms of Dr. Zaleski's world, this is a priority. You may have other things that are priorities in your work, but this, you have to put the brakes on and take care of this. And we did, as you know, an extensive amount of training last year around restraint. We've had great results, but not with any funding. So I just call it out because these are things that take an enormous amount of time on the part of administrators, and it takes funding. Looking for funding sources, you've always been very supportive when we've come to you and made a case for something that we need to do that at this part of the budget we haven't been able to budget for.
Can I ask you to add one to that, because it was a big budget buster, which is the MCAS technology requirements, or MCAS.
Oh, thank you.
Know. That's driven a lot of our technology budget.
Yep.
Do you account for the savings by not heating the library? School committee meeting nights?
I do, Mr. Herr. I just wanted to make
my
point.
I'm saving money.
Right about how in the evenings, you know, I just wanted to make sure. I'm just aiming the heater now.
She only does
chair.
It when you're coming, though, Ryan.
I just got a little nook over here.
I brought a blanket.
World this is my dress.
No, I
have to wear a wool blanket.
Seriously, there's like a breeze.
I want you to know that we are working with the town, actually, Mr. Manzer and Mr. Del Torio, to look at our HVAC system in this building, and that's taking place next week.
So in January, it'll be warmer.
When it goes back to 50 degrees outside.
Mr. Dumas, you are on.
Okay. So before we get into the numbers, I want to say this from the bottom of my heart. Last Thursday night, when I walked out of here, I don't think I was ever as proud to be associated with the Hopkinton Public Schools as I was last Thursday night, following the presentations that were made by the five principals. I know the bottom line with me is the bottom line. It's all about the numbers. But to hear how excited they are about their programs and about their budget requests and to see the results of past budgets that the town and the school committee have funded, it really struck home. I've been doing this work since 1989, and that's a long time. And I was talking to somebody the other day at my association meeting, and I said that the best move I ever made in my career was to come to the Hopkinton and Public Schools. And I really do mean that. So thank you for putting up with me for the past 7 years. So the first slide up there, I'm assuming it's there, that there's nothing new in that slide. It's the enrollment projections from NESDEC. The high school, the middle school, the elementaries, and the preschool come directly from NESDEC. Out-of-district special ed comes from rosters that are provided by the Special Education Department. And vocational, also known as occupational, those are the kids that go to Norfolk Aggie. So I've mentioned before that we currently have 7 students there. 2 of them will be graduating this year. And at this point, we don't know how many students are going to go there next year. But in the past few years, more and more Hopkinton students have been opting for Norfolk Aggie. And so at this point, we have not yet reached the application deadline. That happened sometime, I think, in February. So rather than rolling the dice and saying that nobody's going to go, we just, at this point, have decided to level enroll that school. And that's an expensive school. It costs more than $22,000 a year for tuition, plus we transport the students there. That transportation is, we do collaboratively with some other school districts to minimize the cost. But as you can see, there's an increase of 31 students projected for next year. Since last week, Dr. McLeod and I had a conversation last Friday, and we began the process of taking one final look at the budget requests. And in particular, we looked at buildings and grounds, technology, and Dr. Cavanaugh was nice enough to offer up some money in her curriculum leadership account. So after deliberation with the people who have responsibility for those accounts, we're recommending a reduction of a half FTE custodian at the secondary level. We're reducing the cost for recarpeting the high school main office. Effectively, they requested $40,000 to do the main office and the guidance department. So effectively, what we're saying is you can do one or the other, and I'm going to guess it would be the main office. Middle school technology, this is probably the second or third round of reductions that we've asked Ashok to make. But he's originally we had said to him, can you consider delaying the high school teacher laptop refresh for another year? The laptops are 4 years old. So to me, you know, as a bean counter, they could wait another year. But Ashok pointed out that that could cause some unintended consequences like machines breaking down and that sort of thing. He felt very strongly that he needed to keep that in the budget. So instead, he's willing to delay upgrades at the middle school in the graphics and Project Lead the Way labs. At the high school, he had $10,000 in the budget to provide loaners for students in the one-on-one program. At this point, we're just reducing that by 50%. And then curriculum leadership, some secondary texts were reduced, leaving us with a lower budget request than brought to you last week. And so last week, it was a 4.35% increase, and the budget that we're presenting tonight is 4.13%.
Do you want to just stop for a minute?
Sure.
Any questions so far?
I was just trying to look it up on my phone, and it'll be very slow. But
it's on. So
No, I have this. What I was trying to look up is in the original budget presentation in November 17th, it was even higher than the 4.35.
4.66.
4.66. So I just wanted to say thank you before we get to the rest of it. That's quite a big decrease without a lot of pain, and so I appreciate it.
And Mr. Dumas, are you comfortable if they jump in with questions
Absolutely.
As you go?
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. The next slide, budget development. You've seen this before, but it's been updated for all the changes that were made since that first budget presentation. So originally, we came in, or I won't say we came in, but the principals and directors requested a budget that would have been a 6.99% increase. And we knew, obviously, that certainly wasn't going to fly. So we've continued to make reductions, and it shows the areas, existing staff, reductions, new staff. There will be, you know, we're going to increase new staff next year, but not to the extent that was originally requested. And our expenses has been cut almost in half, the increase. So, again, we're at 4.13%.
Mr. Dumas, before you move on again, I just want to ask a question about actually the prior slide prior to that.
Okay.
But you don't even have to go back to it. But so in pushing off the refresh for the teachers, or that was the one that you felt strongly about,
right.
And pushing off some of these technology expenses, is that creating a must-have for next year in these circumstances? Just trying to get an idea of what our must-haves are going to be next year.
Well, you know, that's a very good question. I believe that these will be pushed into next year. The high school refresh is probably more important than the refreshes at the other schools because of the presence of the one-to-one laptop program.
Mm-hmm.
Because you don't want to have teachers using much older equipment than the students are using.
Yeah.
So that does not really become as big an issue from grade 8 down to grade K. So, you know, we talked a little bit about the possibility of extending the refresh at the other levels in the future.
And I might add that, yes, it would be definitely a push-off as opposed to a removal, definitely something that we want to enhance Project Lead the Way, but it also feels like we put a lot of money into that particular program. We really, and I spoke earlier about engineering and how past budgets have really supported engineering, so we do feel that it could wait. But definitely, as we always, every year, we make decisions based on priorities, and I would expect that would be a higher priority both for Mr. Ghosh and Mr. Keller next year when they're making decisions about what they want and what they can do without.
Okay.
And the custodian one, where is that from?
It would likely be at the middle school. There may end up being a share of a full-time person between the high school and the middle school to backfill it.
And do we think that this is possible because of the fact we're outsourcing some of the outdoor facility work?
That's a really good point, Lori. It's partly because of that, and it's partly because of looking at our current staffing situation that we have a position that hasn't been fully implemented and we seem to be doing fine.
Got it.
So we, in evaluating our needs and going forward with our expectations, I know that we've been adding to both custodian and maintenance over the past few years, and we did get a report from an outside evaluation that was based on square footage and how many we should have, and I feel confident that we're in really good shape now with our current staffing. So although it's in this budget for this year, we think that we can reduce that next year.
Got it. Okay.
Okay, on that budget development slide, if we could go back a slide,
I would like
to point out, yeah, the existing staff original request, the $1,095,000, that is the cost for contractual obligations next year for existing staff, if they had all remained. Just wanted to point that out.
Thank you.
Okay. The next slide is a familiar slide. It shows that consistently payroll has been 82% of the budget. And then on what makes up the payroll budget, have you made the change?
I did. There?
I was trying to follow
along
here.
Oh, sorry.
Okay, yeah.
So,
as I mentioned, contractual obligations, had we done nothing, would have been almost $1.1 million based upon a 2.5% pay raise that's embedded in the contract next year, plus column changes, plus steps, would have been $1,095,000. So personnel reductions, those are rearranging some existing staff, and then FY17 new personnel, which all of this has been reported to you when the various programs have presented.
And that is detailed in...
Is this a good time to talk about this?
Yep.
The proposed staffing
the
levels.
The proposed staffing levels.
Did Mr. Her and Mr. Ryan...
They have them. Okay. Yep. Everybody has those. So it's broken down into the top half and the bottom half. The top half shows the grand total of employees, FTEs, in the school department, regardless of funding source. So there are currently, FY17 actual, 479.6 FTEs. Now the caveat, the little yellow highlight down the bottom, assumes that the 1.9 sped paras that are on the agenda later tonight will be approved. So they're embedded in that 129.5 FTEs for sped. So in the of the 479.6, 31.7 of those FTEs are paid for either by grants or revolving accounts. So in the case, for example, in buildings and grounds, the secretary is paid for by the building use account. The center school and the Elmwood School, that was the literacy coach that up until, I guess, last Friday, was funded by the literacy grant that we got from the state, which got cut, and it's another agenda item tonight. The middle school, the 1.0 adjustment counselor, that's funded by the Metro West grant. The high school, there's a 1.0 adjustment counselor funded by year two of their Metro West grant, and 3.4 teachers funded by the F1 visa revolving account. And then SPED, it's various clerical and paras. Some of them are paid for by the SPED grant. Some of them are paid for by preschool tuitions. I think that's probably all. So the budget currently is funding 447.9. We're requesting, including the 1.0, that will be the 2.5s of the SPED paras from preschool. Those are, I'm assuming that you'll approve those. Those are in the total FTEs of 478.5, and they are also in the, they're part of the offset of the 23.9 because we're recommending that it be paid for by preschool tuitions. So if you look at it budget to budget, we're requesting a grand total of 7.4 FTEs next year, of which 5.1 are actually funded by the operating budget, and 2.3 would be funded by other sources. So the way I'd like to look at it, or I'd like you to look at it, if you could, is rather than looking at budget to budget, look at where we currently are, 479.6. versus 478.5 in total. So what we're really asking for is a net reduction of, I think it's 1.1. And there's all the lists. Obviously, the ones in black are additions, budget to budget, and the ones in red are deletions, subtractions, budget to budget.
That was a lot of information in a very short period of time. Did anyone have any questions on that? No?
I found it surprisingly easy to follow. Thank
you.
Here
we go.
Yes. I'm not known for that.
We just come out of that meeting once again, right?
That was, thank you.
All righty.
Okay.
So, one question. The special education, it's requested to be adjusted in FY17. You guys are voting on that later on tonight, but that doesn't impact 18. 18, you're putting it in there, and then there's an offset to back some of that.
Actually, it's going, the recommendation is to take both years from the revolving account as opposed to the operating budget.
Okay. And on the top side in FY17, actually, you have those two in there?
It's actually 1.9. It's a 0.5, a 0.5, and a 0.9.
Got it.
Next year, it's just a 0.5 and a 0.5.
But that 1.9 is in 17, and then you're showing it in 18 up top as well.
I'm showing it as a 1.0 in 18, because the 0.9 is not going to carry over.
Just for this year.
I got you. Okay.
Yeah.
Yep. Good.
Yeah.
I remember that. Yeah.
When we review the preschool budget later on, it will make more sense, but the 0.9 is a transitional, needing it for the transitional preschool program, and it's purposely planned to only be needed until the end of June.
Okay, and then I think it's, is it the last slide? Oh, no, not quite. What's it called now? We changed the title.
Non-payroll expense.
Non-payroll expense changes. People who don't do what I do for a living have a problem between payroll and expense and understanding them. So we decided to call this slide non-payroll. Okay, it's everything else. It's not payroll. And you've seen all of this before. You know, obviously we've made the adjustments to technology, curriculum, and buildings and grounds. But I would like to point out the next to the last one there, occupational day, also known as vocational, also known as Norfolk Aggie. That's because we only budgeted for 5 in FY17. We have 7. And if we're budgeting for 7 next year, it becomes a budget-to-budget increase. Okay. The next two slides are there to make you feel good.
Should we work backwards? No.
Yeah.
Drum roll.
Per pupil expenditures in surrounding towns. I will point out that these are FY15. This is FY15 data, which is the most current that DESE publishes, because they don't publish them until they get all the end of the year reports in. So they've received our FY16 end of the year report, but they haven't received everybody else's. So they wait and they post this probably in the spring. You'll see the FY16s. So these are the numbers.
I just moved on.
And they're in decreasing order by pupil, by expenditure. And I also would like to point out that this is not just what is spent from the operating budget. It includes everything that's spent from grants, everything that's spent from revolving funds, and equally important from the people across here, it includes the town's contributions towards education costs. The biggest one, obviously, is health insurance for all our school employees, Middlesex County retirement assessments, snow removal, you name it, things that the town does on behalf of the school department that are outside of our budget. And as you can see, I don't know whether there's 13 or 14 towns there, Hopkinton's pretty close to the bottom of the surrounding towns.
So, just before, if I may, and we did discuss, and thank you, Mr. Dumas, Carol and I talked about, well, the logical next slide is, let's reinforce, you know, how our district is rated. But the problem with that is that it depends on where you go, right? I mean, it depends on who's doing it and where we stand. We know that we are very high-achieving, high-performing district, and no matter what numbers you look at. And if we even think about what Carol showed us that with the 97% last week at both of our middle school and high school compared to any other school, all the other high schools and middle schools across the Commonwealth. The fact that we do as well as we do and that we are one of the lower in surrounding towns per pupil expenditure, I think is something that we should be really proud of. It goes to speak to the budget planning that we do, how well we use the monies that are appropriated to us, But I just also wanted to stress, as we end this presentation, that it's because of all of the programs and the resources and the professional development and everything that we're able to do, that to cut back on any of those when we're already one of the lower would be of great concern to me in terms of if that's what the town wants, to continue to be as high performing as we're very proud of the fact that we are. And we will call out all the time that people are moving here because of the schools. And so we feel it's our responsibility to plan a budget that will enable us to continue to provide the programs and the services that result in the achievement that we are so very proud of. So now it's over to you. We're done. The end.
Any other questions?
I don't have any questions, but I just want to, you know, I just want to echo what you said. To go back to where you started, we have a low, compared to some very, very high performing districts on that list, our per pupil expenditure is relatively low, but we have done that and still been able to maintain all of the richness that brings kids to school every day that you started your presentation with: music, drama, athletics, robotics. To me, the closing comment is just really about the value. I mean, obviously, we get more than half of the town's budget. I think adding these kinds of slides really demonstrates to the town, A, that we appreciate it, and B, that we are good custodians of it, and we are really demonstrating a value. And you're right, it is what draws people here. So, you know, I would imagine that if you put the MCAS column next to that, we'd be right at the top, for our performance. And, you know, you could come up with any other pretty ranking that you wanted. There are no shortage of those. But just congratulations, and honestly, thank you for what you do every day for the town and for the students.
And I think we should say thank you to the teachers as well.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
I have one question, just because I know you've told us how this equation works money-wise, but when I do the initial percentage ask of 4.66, and then we're now at 4.13, that's a reduction of 0.53. What does that mean in dollars?
Is it the budget development slide, Ralph?
You probably already gave it to me, and I don't.
Is it the one in the middle there?
Is it this one,
Lauren?
Is it
so?
That number?
Originally, the increase was $1,000,009.
Reduction of 1.173. Okay. Right.
And now it's $1,006,000, almost $1,007,000.
Got it. Okay. This is where my lack of math and finance background comes into play. But I didn't want to, if anyone else had questions or comments, things. That was more of a concrete question I had.
I just wanted to say this is the first time I've done this sitting at the table here, and I am appreciative of how much work went in, not just to make a very clear budget, but to break it down so that those of us who have a little less experience with it could really see where the pennies were going. Thank you.
Thank you.
I liked seeing all the thank you for the past initiatives on there. I know that's something we talked about, and I think that's really important for the people at town meeting to see. And when you post this presentation, I hope they really pay attention to. I hope they get the benefit of hearing it live, because the slides won't tell that story as well as hearing them narrated. Just, you know, thank you because of this. Here's where we are because of where we are. Here's all we're asking for, you know, so we were able to slim down our requests. I hope that they are able to hear it live, just so they hear that natural progression. Right. But I think you've done as well as you can putting that into slides. Mm-hmm. I think they need to hear the story too. Mm-hmm. So, but but it really does tell a very compelling story.
Can I respond to that?
Sure.
Okay. This was your feedback from the last meeting, and I guess the one thing that I realized in this discussion just now is the other thing, and I have felt this since I got here, which is the tremendous support of the families, right? So you're the ones that send your kids to school ready to learn. And I have said that since I arrived here, that we can work with the product that is sent to us, and the product that is sent to us is well-rested, well-fed, well-clothed, with their homework done, all of the things that are done at home to send kids ready to learn. Really needs to be called out as well. So it is definitely a partnership, and I should have included that as well, because I it's something that is really critical. So,
Mr. R, I know you're, I can tell, you're ready.
Like Mr. Kamal when he leans to the microphone.
Oh, he does do that.
So I've seen it now kind of in much more detail this year than I ever have in the past, and it's been very educational. So we create this budget, you guys vote it, it gets put into the town manager's budget, all gets sorted out, let's say it all gets worked out, and it goes to town meeting and passes. Who then owns the budget? Do the principals own the number for their school, and then they get held to that number?
To Mr. Dumas' question.
Who manages the budget and says to Mr. Bishop, well, no, you can't have three more teachers because we only budgeted two. And there's a number for those two and not three. And like, how does it work sort of through the school year?
Mm-hmm. Principals and directors are not held accountable to their salary budgets. And there's a lot of reasons why, and I'll come back to it. They are held accountable to their non-payroll expense budgets by line item. They can't put in a requisition that will overexpend an account without having a conversation with me. Okay, there's just no way that the system will allow that to happen. Now, when it comes to payroll, the reason that we don't hold them accountable to the dollars is because most of the payroll numbers are based upon estimates of teachers who say that they're going to get educational credits, and so that we factor those into their budgets, into the school budgets. But we know that only 30% of the teachers, 30% of the teachers actually earn those credits that will give them a higher pay rate. So what happens is that, for example, the high school would be budgeted for 100% of all the expected costs for their teachers. Central office takes an offset, a credit, to reduce the budget by roughly 70% of the total value of those educational credits. We do, however, hold them responsible for staying within the full-time equivalencies of their teachers. So they can't go and hire an extra English teacher that would make their FTE be higher than the school committee approved without going to the superintendent and the superintendent coming to the school committee to ask for additional funding to cover that.
Do the budget line items get loaded into some software somewhere and you track against that line?
Yeah, it goes right into Munis, which we share with the town. Okay. Yeah, I provide an Excel spreadsheet to the town finance director, and he imports it into Munis.
I think it's been a very thorough process, and I think it's a really clear picture as to what everybody's doing, all the principals are doing, down to the penny. I mean, I was amazed at some of the answers that were given, and I think the return on investment for the taxpayers is very strong.
Thank you. Manning, did you have anything?
I also agree that it's been a very good and transparent process this year, where we have a good understanding as we are each week we're getting fine-tuning the budget to get to a decent number. I do have one question. I know I should have asked about 15 minutes ago about the expenses for the technology. budget. And I know I asked Ashok this question, the same question, about, because you're doing these, you want a refresh of laptops for the teachers. Is this, and I like to see it smoothed out year over year, so you don't have another 50,000 this year, but then you're not going to see it for 4 years, is that a level amount? But what you're planning on is, you know, you can move it into next year. So is there going to be a big spike next year to make up for that in terms of this expense?
Yeah, we talked about that a little bit when we talked about possibly pushing out the refresh for the next round of teacher laptops, not at the high school, but at the lower levels, where you don't have this competition between the students' laptops and the teacher laptops. You want to make sure at the high school level that, you know, they're all relatively compatible. At the lower levels, it's probably not as important. So we've had that conversation, and we'll continue to have that conversation to push it out.
It just gets difficult to budget year over year if you're up 1 year and then down, and, and that's where it becomes a cutting thing. But if it's consistent and you already have a proactive plan each year, you don't have
maybe so, Mr. Bennett, like just to be clear, we talked about potentially cutting the refresh, and then we, in the end, Mr. Ghosh felt strongly that that needed to remain, and he does have a plan that is an ongoing plan. Mm-hmm. So when you see the actual technology reductions, it we didn't touch the refresh for partly because of that reason. But what we've talked about is, instead of it being a four-year refresh, can we start to think about a five-year refresh? And we don't know the answer to that, but it would be something that we'd be able to plan ahead, to your point, over time.
So I think the other thing that Mr. Manning's getting at, and it's just kind of clicked for me when you were saying it, because at first I think what you're mentioning is that, you know, for the different buildings, we have a spike. And whether or not you could take a part of the population in that building and do some each year so that you're not doing them all at once, mm-hmm. it's spreading them out.
Good point.
With Ashok not being here and not being able to ask how that impacts the staff and whether or not there's compatibility between what the staff's doing, I couldn't answer that question, but I see what you're saying in that you then are evening out the refresh over years mm-hmm. instead of having one building be a spike and then the next year another building. I think we're not, on an overall budget perspective, probably, and I don't know for sure, you'd have to correct me on this, but I don't think we're seeing spikes in differences in our budget each year for it because different buildings are on different schedules. But maybe if we did split up buildings, and I don't know if it's possible based on what the interaction of the technology is, it may even it out more. I never thought to ask the question that way, but it's an interesting perspective to put forth.
But just so it doesn't look like you have to take a 1% hit, you know, a big hit in one particular year, because if it's level, then you won't really see an increase.
That's
what I'm getting at. It makes it easier to budget year over year.
The other difficulty we have in some of these contractual situations for technology, too, is that some of the technology we're utilizing, when you put it out to bid, you don't have a lot of competition. You know, like when we're doing anything Apple, it's Apple. We don't have anybody else supplying it. So we also are at the mercy of what their schedules are as well on some of these contracts. But because we've asked that question before as well, like, okay, well, we had one response, and well, that's it. That's all we have for that type of technology. So obviously Mr. Ghosh has been looking at what our technology needs are and operating systems we're in need of, but it's definitely an area that would be worth exploring from a future planning perspective.
Can I just add on to that? I think Ashok has worked really hard to create a technology plan that does even things out over time, but what I will just say is, you know, going back to what we talked about with the unfunded mandates, there can always be something coming that we don't know about, and the changes certainly to the standardized testing that the state has made to require more technology-based testing and whatnot. All of those things are currently in what we have planned, but there always can be something else. But I think that's the added value to what he has done, and you've shown that there's a little bit of flexibility in it, or at least that you're, you know, taking a hard look to see if you can find some flexibility in it when it's needed. So I don't know. I think it's on the website, even the technology plan, but I'm sure you can look at it if you're interested beyond that.
Okay.
And then one last question is basically the expense again was the curriculum leadership, the leadership, because it's a 30% increase. Is that a one-time, one-year expense, or is it going to be consistent from this point on?
Yeah, I think what you're seeing there are probably those science texts. Mm-hmm. So when we showed you the slide where we talk about unfunded mandates, finally, the state did get around to adopting those new standards. So many of the things that may have been taught in fourth grade before are now taught in fifth grade. And so some of the standards have moved up and down grade levels. But the other issue, I think, too, is that there are eight new science practices. So the first three are science, the next two are math, and the last three are literacy related. And so it's really a different way of teaching science than we used to. We used to teach very content-based, and now it's very inquiry-based. So what has happened is we really have had to buy new textbooks that will align with those curricula, and I think that that's why you do see kind of a big jump in there.
So next year is going to be more normalized down to 83, or is there going to be another required textbook that it's going to still be at the same level? Your opinion.
We also have the
teachers. Yeah, right now at the elementary level, we're funding grade 5 science. If I'm not mistaken, won't we need grade 4 next year?
We're funding grade 5 during this fiscal year, grade 4 during this fiscal year, so next year we'll do 5 and 6.
Okay.
And then in the next 2 years, so FY19 we'll have grade 7, FY20 we'll have grade 8.
Right. Okay. Yeah. So it's going to be ongoing for the next couple of years.
So we tried to do it incrementally, but what we at this point, I can't imagine that we have some other sort of change in curriculum that's going to warrant the purchase of new textbooks, although I will say the Department of Education has started to look to revise the social studies standards because they haven't been revised since 2003.
So, thank you. I'm all set.
Okay. Can I just ask one other question, maybe not directly related to budget, but I think for future consideration? Of the top 10 administrators, top 5 administrators, wherever that number is, where are we in contracts with those folks? Or do we have anybody's contract expiring? Anybody's contract got another 5 years on it?
We have a big retirement coming up.
So when you say the top, are you posing that question of me?
You whomever. Asked,
I mean, when you say top 5, do you?
So yourself.
Okay.
You have 2 more
principals.
Years to go.
Yeah, I have 2. We're hiring Carol.
She has 2.
Carol started with us this year. It rotates, Brian. It's not the way it looks. It's not like there's going to be a year when all of a sudden we're looking for several at the same time.
That's kind of what I'm trying to figure out.
Yeah, the way it's been. And you did ask a question 2 meetings ago about, you were asking about, I believe, Mr. Keller's salary at the time. And what we really have been doing is having conversations with the school committee when it comes time to, you know, redo somebody's contract. So, you know, if we want to renew a contract and we want them to stay, we understand that it's a great place to work, but given the amount of experience our administrators have, they're also very attractive candidates for outside districts. So we want to keep them here. And in those cases, you know, there could be an additional increase that's budgeted for somebody who has a successor agreement that's negotiated. Otherwise, everybody is getting the same increase that the teachers are, and that's the way we've been budgeting. Nobody gets more, whatever we've negotiated there. So we nothing is out of line, but we do, and I work with Kim Polnick to make sure that the salaries of our administrators are competitive. And we have had some adjustments to that end that where they were not. Mrs. DeBose's contract is one that comes to mind where it was just not competitive, and we made an adjustment. So right now where we are with some our team that have been in place for a while now, everybody is we feel confident being compensated competitively, and we continue to want to do that because they're key players. We want to hang on to them.
Yeah, I asked it the other day, and I ask it again tonight, maybe because I'm asking it, you're thinking one thing, but in reality it's the other. I want to see stability in our leadership, and I really like what I see everywhere, and we want to try and keep that stability there. It costs more to turn over than to keep.
It does.
So as long as everybody's happy and motivated and held their, you know, meet their objectives and so on, I think the more stability we have, the better off we'd be.
I mean, certainly, I think my response to that is that's always been Dr. McLeod's goal and the school committee's goal, but I think the other reality that we have is that when you have a team that works as collaboratively and is as talented as we have, they strive for other things in their careers as well. And, you know, we're certainly not a district that is wanting to stifle anyone's growth potential. And so they are getting trainings on things that are going to potentially have them move into other districts and other roles. I mean, we have lost some great administrators because of the fact that they moved up into their careers and there wasn't that opportunity available in Hockington. And I mean, I think we have to look at it as, yes, the stability is very important, but in the event that we have lost some administrators due to those types of progress in their career, I see that as also a success for Hockington because we've provided really great training.
That's
so,
a really good point, Laurie.
So it's unfortunate for us that we have lost out on some of that, but I also, I see us do a lot of succession planning within our district in terms of training up our assistant principals and some of the staff within the administrative team so that we have been really successful in hiring from within in a lot of cases, and that provides some stability as well for the kids because they've seen those faces before. So while I think it's possible for us to contractually make it more attractive, I also think that when you have high-performing administrative team, their goals are also high. So we have to be cognizant of that's not all within our control.
Sure.
If there's no other questions or comments, I just wanted to thank you all, myself, because I know that we've been firing questions at you last minute for the last 6 weeks and trying to get explanations on things that might be simple for Ralph especially, but not so simple for all of us. And I really want to also thank the town and all of your involvement, Mr. Herr and Mr. Kamal and Mr. Manning, because you ask questions from a completely different perspective that we sometimes are blinded in our roles in seeing. And so it's opened us up for more conversations than we've had in the past. And I think it's been a really great collaborative process for everybody. And it makes, from my first year of being a part of the process to now, I feel much more confident in what we're putting forth before the town than I would have said 3 years ago. So thank you all as well.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Great. I think we're all set with our budget at this point in time. So if you want to stay, you're more than welcome. But if you want to get into warmer pastures. So our next item on the agenda is the preschool paraprofessional need. And I know that, I believe Dr. McLeod, you're going to present on this, even though we did have a brief discussion about it last week. Thank you both.
I thought it was turf field.
Do I have it wrong?
Isn't that A?
Preschool. Is there an update? Oh, I miss it.
Oh, no, there are two.
There's
of them.
A, B, and C under new business.
I don't know. I didn't get the update. This is why I didn't. You guys didn't call me out when I read out the agenda. I missed this completely.
Either of my agendas.
I don't
didn't
think they sent a revised.
Careful attention.
You read out the agenda.
Okay. Well, we've got the right one.
We're good.
What am I reading?
See you.
Drive safe. Enjoy your day.
Wow. All right, so we actually know we have a discussion on the turf field public forum as letter A. I'm sorry, I don't know. I just printed this out today.
I printed mine out today.
All righty, well, turf field public forum, I guess that is also Dr. McLeod.
Oh, well, just to give safe, Mr. Dumas, you should say that out loud. On the school committee, what page?
On the school committee, on our homepage, if you click on school committee agenda, it's not this agenda.
Yeah.
So it's not.
That's where I printed it from, was the homepage.
You've got it in front of you, though, and I've got Mr.
Do we know it was posted, so we're good?
It was posted.
All right.
Okay.
So
turf?
Turf field.
For consideration and in preparation for a public forum. So the turf committee needs to negotiate a fee to develop a presentation describing the committee's recommendation. And I'm really happy that Jean is here tonight. I'm always happy that Jean is here, but I'm especially happy that you're here tonight, Jean, because I know that you're co-chairing Dee's chairing. You and John are representing the school committee. I was not able to make either of the presentations, and so I know that you have been at every single meeting and you've been doing all the minutes, so if there's any questions, they really should be directed to Jean.
Okay.
But basically, in a nutshell, what we are wanting to do is to approve funding. What the committee wants to be able to do is to go back. They've already been in touch with both Warner Larson and Gail to engage one of those groups to come back and present to the turf field committee on the preferred option, which is fields 4 and 5 as phase 1 and field 3 to include the track as phase 2. And because they gave a much more detailed presentation the first time around, which we had asked them to do, but the committee has determined that this is the plan they want to move forward with. We want to be prepared for both appropriations and for town meeting to have, and a public forum to have community input to the process. So what we need to fund at this point is this preparation with either Gail or Warner to come and meet with the committee to prepare for the public forum. Is that
and
it?
And to present at the public forum, I think.
Thank you.
Too, is the piece. So just to sort of give a little bit more context, we had them look at fields 3, 4, 5, 12, and 13. And so after both of them gave us similar presentations, and it was definitely the feeling of the subcommittee that because of cost and value, it doesn't really make sense to pursue fields 12 and 13. So what this money would do is to have them create a little bit more detail around fields 4 and 5 and around there are a couple of options that you could consider on field 3 so that we are ready for a public forum to get input on all of those different scenarios, what the priorities are of the town versus regarding usage and public usage for our athletic teams and whatnot. And I wanted to just say that we have been trying to figure out a funding source, and Mr. Dumas bailed us out by reminding us about the account that we have that we've been depositing the money in that from our contract with the BAA and the 26.2 Foundation for the rental of the property for related to the marathon. So we do have money in that account, and I believe that is where this $4,500 would come from. And in addition, we're hopeful that so you remember we already voted to spend money out of that account for the cross-country course, but we should still have enough funds in that account so that we will be able to hopefully pay for the design money as well, and then the goal would be to be ready to request at annual town meeting in May project funding for a project, phase one of a project, but that's obviously more work that needs to be done in the community. So that's kind of the down and dirty update about the work that we've been doing thus far. And
my one question is, we had talked before about having a presentation to the school committee and the turf committee. Is the plan for the presentation to be to the turf committee and then to just request that the school committee come to the public forum? I mean, obviously that would be our goal to be there anyway, but is that there's not a separate presentation for the school committee?
We actually didn't talk about that, but that is a great you're right, we did talk about that as a school committee. As a subcommittee, I don't think we did talk about that, and I do think you're right, that's an important piece. So we could talk to them about coming to, what are our January meetings?
January the 5th is our regular school committee meeting, and then the 9th is our special meeting where we, the public forum.
The public forum.
Right,
so
and then the 19th is when we would actually vote the budget, but it's also a regular meeting.
Yep.
Right. Okay. So our next subcommittee meeting for the athletic fields is January 4th.
Yeah.
So actually, that would be great if we could invite whomever to come on the 5th and give the presentation. That would get it out in the public as well before the forum, which is scheduled, I'm pretty sure, the 10th, right, Kathy?
The forum
is the 10th, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's a great suggestion. The reason this isn't specific to one versus the other is that, you know, both of them gave very similar presentations and are perfectly capable of adding the extra detail and would have to go through the public bidding process to ultimately become our designer anyway. So at this point, you know, we're not picking one over the other. We're just, based on availability and cost, we'll have one of them do this presentation.
Okay. We could also pull the school committee to see about their availability for the 4th.
Yeah, it's at 8 a.m. on the 4th. The advantage to doing it here is that it's televised.
That's true.
And would help us publicize the forum.
Very good.
And I see another member of our subcommittee here. I wonder if he thinks it's a good idea if we do a public presentation on the 5th.
The more we talk about it public, I think the better off.
Yeah, that's a great suggestion.
Okay, great. Once in a while.
No.
Did anyone else have any questions or comments about it? All right. Did anyone have any concerns about the motion that I now actually have in front of me? All right. So if there's no more discussion, no questions, then I would seek a motion to approve the funding not to exceed the amount of $4,500 for
Jim, are you waiting on words?
The turf field committee to negotiate a fee to develop a presentation describing the committee's recommendation from the central office gift account.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Kavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. And that is four yeses and one absence. And it passes. And our next item on the agenda is elementary literacy coach position by Dr. McLeod.
Thank you. In your packet, you will see the copy of the letter that we were devastated to receive, and you know, from the state, basically telling us that, you know, that $200,000 we gave you, we'd like $180,000 of that back. Basically, they had never given us any more than 20, so it wasn't like we had to scramble to find funds, but you know that I came here so excited about what this was going to enable us to do. There was also, you know, I won't say significant in comparison to other things that we do, but a lot of work that went into not only preparing the grant, but back and forth with DESE and lots of support from Senator Spilka's office to help us to get it. So it was really frustrating. And I innocently and naively thought, oh, no worries. It's a budgeted position. She has a contract. So, of course, we have to at least be able to keep the money that's funding the position, until I came to work on Monday morning and Mr. Dumas and Ms. Polnick just burst my bubble and said, nope, sorry. It's you can actually give notice and, you know, and basically get rid of the position. So I want to say that I personally have observed Deb Moriarty, who is the individual that we hired as the literacy coach. She is doing already, in the short time that she's been with us, just really powerful work. Not only professional development, but the truly the coaching position that we had envisioned would be in place. And I just went and at the meeting with Mr. Dumas said, you need to help me find the funding to keep this position, not only for this year, but because we want it. If we lose her, we're going to lose her. She won't be available to us next year. We had posted for literacy coaches over the past 3 years. Very difficult to find. You can find a reading certified person who's a reading teacher, but that coaching, the talent to be able to work with teachers in a way that is collaborative and not threatening, is really, really tricky to do. And so Deb loves working here, is definitely somebody that would want to continue. And so I just basically tonight's consideration is to be able to fund the remaining of the position for the remaining of the year, which comes to $50,595. $20,000 of the grant will be put towards only her salary. We're not going to use the grant money for anything else that we had originally wanted to use it for, because we agree, and when I say we, I mean Lauren and Anne and I, and Carol, working with this position, which is impacting those two buildings. So this can be funded very appropriately through the special education, because the impact is on all students. She's working with also resource room teachers, special education teachers, helping them look at data. The training that I saw last week had to do with consistently interpreting BAS results across buildings, so that there is the same types of information going from second grade to third grade and from fourth grade to fifth grade. I wondered what you were looking at.
It's mesmerizing. I'm sorry.
I thought it might have been a picture of Deb up there.
And what I was looking at up there is there's a water bottle on the top of that.
Yeah.
And I'm like, how did that get up there?
So that hopefully means that you're already convinced and I can stop talking. But seriously, it is such an important position, and I am very hopeful that you will consider and make a motion to allow us to fund and hang on to this critical position.
The person is in next year's budget filling a retirement, okay, as a reading teacher retiring at the Elmwood School next year, at the end of this year, I should say. So the idea was always to move her into the budget, because this was only supposed to be a one-year grant.
So this is a one-time expense?
Yes.
So I have a question. I didn't know that there was an amended packet, so I was reading it. The language that they use in their letter, they talk about must amend the performance anticipated. There is nothing that the district did that caused this except for cuts at the state level,
yeah,
correct?
This was governor's,
the language in the letters.
Yeah, it was the governor's 9C cuts.
Where are you reading that, Kelly?
Oh, it says, due to recent spending reductions, we've been required. Da, da, da.
Yeah.
The department must amend the performance anticipated under the grant. It's just that, weird.
Wording. That means their performance of paying us the grant.
Yeah, no, it's that department.
Like, okay. Oh, performing the payment.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Because then they say performance level authorized. No, it's just the word performance is all in here, and it has nothing to do with job performance. It has nothing to do with district performance. It's all about just cuts at the state level.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thanks.
We weren't the only district that was impacted by the 9C cuts. There was a whole laundry list of them in the Metro West Daily News last week. That's when I first saw it, and I says, oh, boy.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you.
Is the amended packet in your shared folder?
It's in the drive, but we didn't get any note that there was.
Okay, I'll take care of that.
It's not marked as revised, right?
Okay, thank you.
There's a date difference. That's the only way you can tell.
All right.
But they're both listed as the 15th packet. I didn't realize I hadn't downloaded the right one.
Me okay, either. I'll do a better job of clarifying that.
You're making me feel better.
There we go. That was my purpose, is just
it
right.
Was yesterday.
I'll make sure that we notify you when there have been last-minute changes. So the good news is that the agenda that had been amended was posted. And
perfect.
Yes.
Did anyone have any questions on the motion? All right. At this time, I would seek a motion to approve $50,595 to fund literacy coach position to be funded from the balances in the special education accounts.
So motion.
Okay. Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Four yeses, one absence, and so carries.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
Also in your packet, this is a repeat of the paraprofessional memo that Ms. DeBow explained last week. You had asked me to bring it back. Obviously, because we didn't have it listed under new business. So it's back on the agenda. It's the same information that we went through last week. Certainly, if there's additional questions, we would obviously like to address them.
So
Because we're just use some funds from special education. So this one's coming from preschool fund. It's not coming from special education account.
It's coming from the preschool tuition revolving account.
Okay. Any other questions?
I know we had extensive conversation on this last week.
Last week, yeah.
All right. Then we will move right along. I seek a motion to approve the addition of 1.9 level C paraprofessionals to be funded by the preschool revolving account.
Put it back in.
That's yours.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. There's four with one absence, and it basically passes. There you go. Under old business, we have the HCA parking agreement, which was also in your agenda materials, and I believe Dr. McLeod included all of the changes that we had discussed at the prior meeting.
Yes, I did. The most important one, I think, is on page 2 of the agreement under D, where Nancy had recorded Lori's language. Is that how it went down?
Anyway, I don't remember, but it looks right.
I did have Ms. Nickerson's language, and I did meet with the HCA. You have a signed. I actually have the original signed for Lori's signature. He's gone now. And then we need to get a signature from the town. We had a very collaborative meeting. That's when I was able to have the conversation about what are the kinds of things that we're being able to use the organization. They thought that the recommendation under D made complete sense and it made it much more understandable. We also called out labeling, making it more clear as to what parking area we were talking about. That was the only other significant change. Premises located, I think it says the closest controls a parking lot adjacent to the leased premises. We also already, the three of us, have a meeting on our June calendars so that we make sure that this six-month piece doesn't get forgotten. And so we will come back together in June. But we're very excited to move forward and about the opportunities for collaboration and for watching the development and the growth of the HCA. Every night when I drive by and the lights are on, and right now there's a beautiful lit tree in the front. It's just such a beautiful addition, I think, for the town, and to have access to something like that. So I'm happy that we've been able to help in whatever way we can. That's it. So now there's a motion.
Does anybody have any other questions, concerns on the draft?
No. I think it really captured everything that we talked about.
Great. All right. At this time, I would seek a motion to approve the parking agreement between the, I'm looking at this, it's the HCA and the Hopkinton Public Schools as amended and included in the agenda materials.
And thank you for picking up on that error in the motion, because it does say HPA. HCA, yes.
So moved.
Sorry.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And that is four yeses and one absence. Passes as well. We have our second opportunity for public comment, which we have no one here for public comment tonight, so we can move right on to our items by consensus.
I believe I have right.
Everyone. Yeah, I do. We only have one item, an item by consensus, so I'm assuming no one wants to break anything out. Go ahead, Dr. McLeod.
The superintendent recommends the school committee move to approve the item by consensus as outlined below.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Birchman, seconded by Mrs. Cavanaugh. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And there's four yeses and one absence. That also passes. And I would seek a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mrs. Cavanaugh, seconded by Mrs. Birchman. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. And we are adjourned. Oh, I hate this clock from here. I'm sorry. I'm
7 minutes of 9.
At 8:54. Our next meeting is in the new year, scheduled for Thursday, January 5th at 2017 at 7 p.m. here in the high school library, which is a regular meeting. And then on Monday, January 9th, here in the high school library, we'll have a special meeting and public hearing on the school district's budget. And thank you, and happy holidays. Yay.